Welcome back to the joinDOTA League European Division Finals. It is game number three in this best of three between My Insanity and Moscow 5. My Insanity are able to take game number one. I would say they had control of the game pretty consistently. Moscow 5, though, came back and struck hard in game number two, man. A 19-minute double-raxing GG call? Yeah, that's some serious knockback, man. I honestly, going into this game as My Insanity, I'd be like, it's either one way or the other, right? You're either rattled by that and just be like, oh god, we just got demolished. Like, how do we go into game number three after that? Or you look in the opposite light and you're just like, we just screwed up the draft. It's fine. We'll just go into game number three. Better draft, different deal. We just got surprised by a heavy push lineup. And that's that. And just shake it off and go into game number three. We'll see how My Insanity. Well, to start with, they banned away the Tusk, which was probably a pretty good ban because Screen, I mean, it was a little bit too yellow for my taste. Some of the snowballs were, I mean, they dove a tier two before the horn blew. They were diving a tier four towers
10 seconds
at like 17 minutes. So, you know, a little bit too yellow for my taste, but Screen did play a really good Tusk. And Tusk as a whole did operate very well up against the lineup that My Insanity were running. So you got to give them that much. Though we're definitely going to be seeing a much, much different game. There's going to be no possibility of this game. No matter how badly one team is getting stomped, there's no way we're going to be seeing a double waxing before the 20-minute mark for this game. We start out with a Wisp and Tiny combo for Moscow 5, while My Insanity run with a support carry combo of their own, which is the Ancient Apparition Faceless Void. Now, this could be a Faceless Void offlane. It's always a possibility here. But for now, we're going to bank on the Faceless Void being our main carry. While Moscow 5 probably going to be running dual lanes, which is the norm for Wisp Tiny at this rate. Probably expecting to see the Wisp Tiny in the middle lane, though it kind of depends on what they're running up against. Bans coming out, though. Moscow 5 obviously are going to be banning away the most threatening of mid heroes and actually can deal with the dual lane. And that would most primarily be the Viper. I would say Razor may be a value ban, but instead they take away the Lycanthrope, which you can completely understand that, seeing as the success that both teams have run it with. Meanwhile, My Insanity banned away the Doom as well as the Puck, so taking away some of those big silencing heroes. The Puck, well, seeing as they're running an Ancient Apparition, you got to recognize some of your weaknesses, right? The Ancient Apparition is able to provide you a lot of good, really, really strong mid to late game power with just one ability, right? It's the only ability that matters, right? The Ice Blast. If you're able to get an Aghanim's upgrade, Ancient Apparition does some serious work. And I'm actually really not surprised by that Sand King pickup, because if you look at it, Ancient Apparition doesn't really provide you a whole lot of control, i.e. none, pretty much, unless some other long duration stuns or something weird happens and you actually get that cold feet proc to land, you're not providing any control to lane whatsoever. So heroes like Puck, pretty easy for them to be able to work around an Ancient Apparition. Even with the early harassment, right, phase shift, plus the orb, you've got plenty of ways to be able to not only deal damage back to the Ancient Apparition, dodge some of the damage that's incoming to you, but in general, just play pretty aggressively off of the Ancient Apparition's low HP pool, and you should be able to win the lane as an offlane Puck. And then you look at the other support pickup here, which is the Sand King, who, again, is not a hero that's known too much for his level 1 power. Burrow Strike being very, very low range means that he's not a terribly threatening support hero in the first 5 minutes. Now, he's able to do some things that many other supports can't, which is he's able to farm up the jungle really effectively, but it means he's a very greedy pick overall. So when you're running two, I would say, pretty greedy pickups like this, you want to make sure that's not going to be abused by really powerful offlaners. So the Puck would be very good. They don't really have a whole lot of control, so the Puck's low HP pool but high mobility would be really good, abusing My Insanity quite heavily. While the Doom, a big tanky hero that is able to get a lot of regen out of his ultimate, or out of a Scorched Earth to keep himself alive, would probably do pretty well as well, because we're expecting the Faceless Void to be in one position here, and it looks like that's going to be the case. The Clockwork should be our offlaner for my Insanity. Moscow 5, though, they just paired up a Crystal Maiden with an Invoker. So this could be a Tiny Whisk combination in the middle lane. There's only the mid hero left to be picked up by my Insanity. And they're afraid of the Zeus. Completely understandable why. A good hero that's quite good at harassment, but is able to sit super, super far back and still get a lot of CS. So he's not going to be in danger of being hit by the Tiny Initiation, but can still actually do quite well in the middle lane. So that's definitely a smart ban, taking away the Zeus. But so far, I actually don't think there's any heroes left that can do really well versus a Tiny Wisp. Like, I think Razor actually does pretty well in those 2v1 scenarios, but he's not as good as a Viper would be, because he's still a bit squishy, and he's actually quite susceptible to the combination of the Tiny, because it's not single-target based. So the AoE control that the Tiny has is actually quite good, because Razor's passive won't actually help him out in any way. So instead, it's going to be the Death Prophet. Yeah, I would say that's probably the best hero left. One of the mid spammers, like DK, Death Prophet, any of those heroes that will abuse a bottle and spam some sort of AoE creep clearing ability over and over again, is probably going to be your best bet. But I still say you're going to be running the Tiny Wisp mid. You're going to be having the Invoker as your safe lane farmer paired up with a Crystal Maiden, I believe. Now, there's possibility that they run the offlane Invoker, though I would be a bit hesitant about that. And my Insanity believe that the Invoker is not going to be there. In fact, they banned away the Broodmother. Really smart ban, because they could have been abused by that. Right? If I believe they had the first ban, right? Yeah, they had the first ban. So if you don't ban away the Broodmother and they ban away the Death Prophet, you're like, oh, we need some sort of AoE clearer to be able to deal with the Broodmother. But we don't really have anything. Like, we have Clockwork Rockets, that's meh. We have Sand King, Burrow Strike, and Caustic Finale, but that's meh as well. You need one of your cores to really be good at dealing with Broodmother, if you have any hope. So, definitely a smart ban there. Omni Knight is going to be the last pickup here, and that should be our offlane hero. So, definitely interesting. I think probably just tanky enough to be able to deal with the kind of weak overall tri-lane of my Insanity, though he's still going to be susceptible to a lot of right clicks. I feel like once until he has level 3, maybe even level 4, like when, if he can get to level 4 without dying, I think he'll actually be good for the rest of the lane, because that degen aura is going to be quite good versus the Faceless Void, because that's actually where a lot of the extra bit of damage is going to come in, right? The Faceless Void jumps on him when they try and get a Burrow Strike combination, and that bit of a slow plus a couple right clicks, maybe a bash in there, that's actually going to be a decent amount of damage. But if you can get the slow, the degen aura from the Omni Knight to be able to provide you that extra bit of distance, right? The Faceless Void jumps on you, you start running away, you kind of keep some of those right clicks down by just being able to slow down the Faceless Void's pursuit of you. That'll help somewhat. Obviously, you want the maxed out purification, because that's going to be the way that you survive through these ganks. And the repel, obviously, because you're going to need it probably versus some of the magic damage that's coming out from the Sand King as well as the Ancient Apparition. I'll be interested to see how he manages to work this one, though. Necroman, safe lane farming up the Invoker. Could be going for an Exort build here. We've been seeing a lot of Quas Wex Invokers lately. I would say that this patch that we probably have the most, I would say the most balanced Invoker that we've had for quite some time. This is just my own personal feelings. I don't really play Invoker that much, but from watching it, I feel like Exort Invoker is still completely viable, but Quas Wex Invoker has been buffed up enough that it's definitely viable, especially with the way that it's been seeing so much popularity lately. So I'm curious to see which build he thinks he should be going for here. Tornado, definitely good no matter what. Moscow 5 turns around, gets the stun, no big deal. And the end. my insanity will be blocking out the hard camp. Now, last time they did this, they tried to do this earlier. In game number one, up against the Sand King that Moscow 5 was running, they placed a ward right here. And that was immediately countered, didn't do anything for them. This time around, they tried to get a little bit sneakier with it. And they killed that tree and threw down the counter ward there. It should still be fairly obvious, I would say, for Moscow 5. Now, Grazine's kind of be kind of caught out here, because ZXE is still on the side. Lands a stun, not going to be able to get enough right clicks in, it looks like, though. They still defend the early rune, looks like, at bottom lane. The Void was able to get that one, so a trade-off. Both teams get a bounty rune, and both teams actually expend a lot of mana fighting over said mana said bounty rune. But yeah, they actually got a bit sneakier here. Now, that's definitely a smart play all around, because the problem with running this bottle-first Wisp is that you're not likely to go for any counters. So even if they did just lay down the ward in the middle of the camp, it's not going to be countered right away because they don't have a secondary support, essentially. He's going for a bottle first. He's not getting any support items in the first first, you know, 2 to 3 minutes of this game. And obviously one of the biggest strengths of being able to run the Wisp tiny mid is not necessarily having the Wisp sit in the middle lane the whole entire time, but have him bounce back and forth. Have him stack up both this hard camp as well as this medium camp, and this just tether into the lane and bottle up whenever your mid needs some extra HP. You can see the bottle already coming into play. He's going to heal both himself as well as ZXE back up to full. Or at least he will eventually here. Meanwhile, in the bottom lane, we do have a Faceless Void farming up next to an Ancient Apparition. While Slander is trying to make this Omni Knight offlane work for him. Looks like he's doing quite well. In fact, he's going to be level 3 off of this one. Middle lane, Screen in some trouble. They had a nice 2-man stun there in Screen. Getting quite low, but able to stay one step ahead. Another tether is coming out. Toss, Mitch. Screen's going to try and help him out, but oh, wow. That was a big right click there from Milan. I expected Milan needed two more hits, or one more hit after that, but just one big right click is all it took, and Screen ends up feeding away the first blood in a daring attempt to try and help the Tiny get the kill on the Sand King. Ends up failing pretty miserably, though. And oh, at least they're going to get Milan here. At least they should. They chase her down, bottle, not going to be enough. And again, the bottle coming into play means that ZXE will be happy sitting in this middle lane. Not quite going back up to full health, but pretty damn close. Yeah, Cole is definitely being abused quite heavily. They don't really have the threat of a Sand King like in this bottom lane, so without any sort of stuns, the Omni Knight's just going to run rickshaw over these two. Now, the Sand King does come back to this bottom lane, even teleports out to do so, but it may be a bit too late. Level 4 is up for the Omni Knight, and he's sitting quite healthy right now. He's got a Purification up. They're going to go for this kill, slow him down. He's actually going to try and teleport away. Nice rappel play. And teleports away quite easily. Our other offlane, Green, not doing quite as well as the Omni Knight is. But he's up against a much more dangerous lane. Two different ranged heroes, plus another hero that can potentially bounce in from long range. That's why he's got this ward right here, though. Grazine gets caught out by the tornado with the cold snap as well as the icicle. Clockwork didn't really stand a chance there. So we are going to be seeing the Quaswex Invoker. I think that's probably the best play here. I think an early Orchid Invoker could do a lot of work versus this team of My Insanity. Is they're going to be able to catch out the Death Prophet here. Trying to chase him down, ZXC just needs another right click after that last one, and they'll get it too. No teleports in whatsoever. Nice trade off of the tower aggro as well to make sure that they both survive. But yeah, no TP's in whatsoever from the side of my insanity, kind of leaving their Death Prophet out to dry there. I think that's primarily because their supports, I mean, the Ancient Apparition straight up can't do anything, right? You teleport in with an Ancient Apparition, nothing's going to happen. He throws maybe a cold feat. That doesn't really stop those heroes from running at you. And it would namely be on the Sand King, but of course he really doesn't have any farm just yet. He does have this hard stack that he's trying to deal with right now. In fact, he's probably going to sap level 3 from this middle lane. So he will get some farm eventually, but for now he doesn't really have anything to work around. Denied. Yeah, slander. He hit level 4, now he's level 5. He's got that extra level in the nuke. He just takes over the lane at this point. A bit surprised that we're not going to be seeing like a Ring of Bacillus for Radiant's the Omni Knight, just because I feel like attack. That extra bit of presence. Ring of Bacillus plus an Orb of Venom, and this Omni Knight would just have total dominance over the lane. Mid lane? Ooh, Mitch. Radiant's Sandstorm just in time. Screen is bottling up. Oh, the Clockwork Rocket! Grazine actually teleported in, and the level 1 Clockwork Rocket was enough to be able to get the kill. So good rotation this time around. I mean, you're rotating with a hero that actually doesn't do much without his ultimate. Grazine trying to catch up to PGG here. Hits him with the flare. But we'll be backing up. Yeah, he knew. He was kind of getting baited in that Necroman. Who's going to be coming in. Still could hit him with the tornado here if it's long enough range. No. Doesn't actually hit it. Milan. Oh, God. Tornado goes up, actually stops the extra bit, but Milan, he needs to be able to get off the nuke here. Finally does get it off, but he's going to be in a really bad position as he runs himself away from Necroman. He needs some help. He's got some bottle charges coming up. Grazine coming in with the cogs, and they're actually going to turn on Necroman here with the Burrow Strike onto Necroman, and, well, the bottle heal's coming out from screen, but it's not going to be enough. At least they get the Death Prophet in return. The toss-up, Grazine, they're both going to be really low from this one. Beautiful toss from ZXC. And now it's a simple chase down maneuver. Whoa, jeez, that one right click from ZXC. It did 133 damage to our poor Sand King. And man, the CIS scene certainly does not disappoint. 4-6, 7 minutes in. Once again, way over one kill per minute so far. PGG is... He's actually got quite the number of levels so far in his Crystal Maiden. He's just about to hit level 6, which is much bigger than it used to be for Crystal Maidens, because Freezing Field is actually a viable ultimate, besides being kind of trashy, like it used to be back in the day. But after repeated buffs, it is now super strong. And, well, he doesn't actually go for it at level 6, but whenever he does choose to have it, at least he has that option now. It's still a question of positioning. How often are you really going to be in a position early game to be able to get off a good Freezing Field? But man, the AoE is so huge. Lizard, I think he's dead. I think he's actually just going to be right-click down. Nope, Slander's forced to back up. Maybe if he had an Orb of Venom. Maybe then that'd be enough slow. Seriously, value Orb of Venom. So good. It is so good. You're only losing yourself 136, 7, whatever, gold, because you could sell it back. So if you get one kill thanks to an Orb of Venom, it's worth it. It's well worth it. Milan trapped. Beautiful play there by Slander with his Invis rune. Now trying to chase in for more. Lizard's going to be slowed down here, but Slander's not going to be going for the kill. Instead, just repel and TP out. They got a kill. They bought space. Look at the top lane. Necroman as well as PGG are about to push that one in.
Radiant structures are fortified. Radiant's top tower is under attack.
That's a relocate. Toss. ZXC, he's going to need to toss the Wisp here if they hope to be able to. Well, and maybe he could just chase him down. Lizard tries to juke. It barely gets clipped by that avalanche. And I forgot they were chasing a poor, squishy Ancient Apparition. He really doesn't have any HP at all to survive through an avalanche, let alone a combo. Tiny has just finished up his drums, so still going to be going for the drums. We've actually seen a number of Tinies recently not go for drums anymore because they're, I would say they're more a support-oriented item than a core item. Solely because of some of the stats that it's basically activating the drums is better, but just holding on to the drums is a bit worse. And that makes it better for supports and not as good for cores. Now, it's still good on the Tiny, and I do like this pickup, mainly because the stats are so perfect for what the Tiny needs at this point. He still needs extra movement speed, and the movement speed he gives to the Wisp is really, really valuable. It's not just about the movement speed for himself, but then it's also the extra stats that he gets, not only strength, but also the mana increase that he gets out of its screen. Picks up a haste rune, is going to try and run himself away from the last couple of right clicks. Oh, again! One right click. Again, I'm deceived by the Death Prophet's damage. Not realizing it's going to be enough. Hookshot misses. Double tornado. Toss up in the air as well. Milan's still going to try and chase down Necroman here, who does not have an invoke. He has no way to be able to save himself with the Ghost Walk here. Stun on to three. Toss up. And it actually dunks both of them. Death Prophet and the Sand King fall. Necroman's just checking that box. He says, worth it, worth it, worth it. I'll take that trade again because ZXC is about to get huge with a third kill in his basket. As he tosses up another one, this time the Wisp does get the kill, but still. Three kills for one. And, or are they about to get another here? Cole able to jump ahead just ahead of ZXC. Toss in the Crystal Maiden, and with a freeze, Cole... He's going to need a Chronosphere here. He has the Chronosphere. I'm not sure why he's trying to wait. Oh, no. Screen, Tether gets killed by Mitch as well as Lizard. And these heroes are pretty far deep. With the right teleports in, maybe they can stop this. Mitch is going to be dunked once again, and he just keeps going. This Tiny doesn't stop. They go up the staircase, and with Slander there, PGG is just fine as well, and a whole entire, like, full one-minute dive past that Tier 1 tower. Ends up resulting in a perfectly fine situation for Moscow 5. They lost the Wisp, that's all. They got a ton of kills for that Tiny, though. 9-0-2. This guy only has 28 CS, and yet he is probably the most farmed hero by far on the map. Necroman, able to sneak himself away from Grazine just barely. Relocate in, Cole kind of caught out here. Chronosphere, oh god. Execution from the Holy Warrior. Omni Knight lays down the Purification and it just destroys his Faceless Void. I haven't seen him get a backtrack yet, but it's only level 1, so it's not really fair to be expecting it. Seriously, though, his Faceless Void just needs to throw down the Chronos, man. That last situation where he just refused to Chrono, the two heroes chasing him like that. Like, I don't care if you're not going to get any right clicks down. Just hold them there. You're going to get out, and you hold the enemy in a really bad position for 3 seconds. No problem. That just means that your allies should be teleporting in and taking advantage of the fact that they're way too deep. Lizard. Oh, no. Not like this, buddy. Not like this. Beyond godlike. Radiant's top tower. The Wrecking Ball that is Tiny just bulldozed our Ancient Apparition for like the fifth time this game. Fifth time, only 3 deaths. Toss him, toss him. Oh. Oh, they're still going to catch him. Oh, Milan, why did you turn around, my friend? Now he's going to try and toss the Tiny. Stay away. Oh, wait, Tiny. Oh, left side, Necroman. He's been caught by Grazine. Heal goes off, Purification, and the toss. Grazine has no hopes of surviving through that one. Ultimate goes off, but already the counter ultimate from Slander. Meanwhile, a nice Chronosphere, but they just do not have the damage. They'll finish off the Wisp, but they can't threaten any of the cores, and now they'll be in a really bad position. Mitch, in fact, he just turns around. He leads the enemy away from the Faceless Void, knowing that he's got no possibility of escape there. And it's too bad, though. He was getting really close to his Blink Dagger, too. Tornado trying to catch Milan, but not quite enough by itself. ZXC 7,300 net worth right now. Purification? Oh, so close. All right, well, we've got some damage now on our Faceless Void with the Mask of Madness and the Hand of Midas that he's picked up. He's got a lot of attack speed. Still need like a Maelstrom or at least upgraded boots before you really feel this Spaces Void is a threat to any of the cores on this team. But he can easily kill supports, that's for sure. Grazine looking for his opportunity to jump in, doesn't see it. And will back himself away, and instead they're going to be looking for an opportunity in the top lane. Though Necroman, I would say he's more than tanky enough to deal with this. In fact, I don't think they have. They have one Sentry Ward. But I have a feeling if they tried to go on Necroman, they wouldn't actually kill him. If anything, Necroman would kill them. Look at this guy. He's almost got the Orchid. Yeah, he's got the Orchid now. So a 15-minute Aghanim's, 15-minute Orchid. So at this point, if they don't group up, they die to the Invoker. And this is the one thing that I really, why I thought Orchid Invoker would be really, really good here, the Quas Wex Orchid, is that if you don't group up, the Invoker, the Quas Wex Orchid Invoker, will constantly pick people off. It's super easy to get kills. Even up against the toughest of cores, they can't deal with the Cold Snap, Right Click, plus Orchid combination. It's really, really deadly. It's an amazing amount of single target damage. Top lane, relocate. Milan in some serious trouble. Gets off a beautiful silence there. Still in a lot of trouble. Gets Right Click down by the rest of Moscow 5.
Mark these words. They're the last you
But if you don't group up, you die to the Invoker. If you do group up, though, you're just going to have this Tiny constantly split-pushing you. Cole comes in, trying to finish off PGG, but the double heals come out, and Cole's going to die inside of his own Chronosphere. A damn shame, and now the rappel onto Grazine makes it too easy for ZXZ to find another Beyond Godlike spree, while the Invoker looks like an Orchid pickoff on the Sand King, who once again was getting very close to his Blink Dagger. This time he does have it, but it feels like it's a bit too late. This is looking even more one-sided than the game number two that we just witnessed. And what did I say? There's no way there could be a double ranking by 20 minutes? Well, this is true. Moscow 5 don't have that kind of team that is able to push down towers that quickly. But this is actually just as one-sided, if not more one-sided. Because that push lineup that Moscow 5 were running in game number two has a certain amount of fragility to it, where if they're not able to successfully make the base pushes work, they're going to be in some serious trouble, right? If they can't actually take that first set of racks by 25 minutes, they will actually start dropping off quite heavily, and things will get harder and harder as time goes on. Here, this team, Moscow 5's lineup, doesn't actually drop off at any point. Tiny Wisp, they only get bigger. The Invoker only gets bigger. The Omni Knight, an incredibly good, one of the best utility heroes you can have going into the late game, right alongside like a Darkseer going late game. If you can get an Aghanim's and have a refresher, Omni Knight doesn't even need to be, he can sit in the fountain, man, and perform a brilliant job in every team fight. He just ultimates, waits, refreshes, ultimates again, team fight won. I mean, even if you have the fusels, the refresher is going to make it hard for you to deal with double ultimates. So this Moscow 5 team, They may not be pushing down Arrakis just yet, but with the way their lineup is built, they're just as far ahead as that they were in game number two at this point. A 15,000 gold lead. A 12,000 experience lead. Aghanim's for the Omni Knight in just a minute or two. Oh, right side, we do have PGG, who's going to be picked off by Grazine, so double ultimates for support. You know what? We'll take it, right? My Insanity don't have a whole lot of options at this point. Every single kill that they can get, they need. Just fully commit at this point.
Do it with flair.
Roshan, I don't know how they can take this fight. The Death Prophet, Invoker, looks like he tried to go in, ended up getting spotted out by the Counter Ward. But they're going to chase around this Invoker so much. Meanwhile, Roshan still being right-clicked down. My Insanity really need a big ultimate initiation here from Cole. But the Chronosphere's not up for another 3 seconds. This could be a big opportunity. If he catches Omni-Knight especially, this could be huge. Jump in, they're going to be able to grab both of them. Slander comes in for the side, gets silenced! This is the combo they needed right here! Screen's going to be falling. Now ZXZ caught up inside the pit with no help from anybody. PGG, could he get off the ultimate? Oh my god, ZXZ is actually getting away, Ghost! Not enough damage! He is actually fast enough to be able to get out. They're going to try and go for Roshan here. EMP going out, Tornado. This might have just gone. If they can actually get Aegis here, this could be so huge for them. They will be able to lock down that much. Stun onto Necroman. Meanwhile, our Crystal Maiden actually jumps in for Cole. Gets silenced up. Healed. Right click. Oh, he got the bash. He gets off. Just, oh, not even enough damage. 10 health. Are you kidding me? Cole survives. Keeps his Aegis intact for the next upcoming fight. And holy cow, now they're, oh, there goes the Aegis. Relocate in. They're going to try and get him again here. They do have Avalanche here. The stun. Oh, God, Cole. That was an Avalanche and a single right click from the Tiny. They may still get him, though. You see this on the side. Necroman coming in. Orchid. And Cole's dead. Unless he backtracks like a god. Which, with only level 3, not going to happen. Well, I mean, that was definitely a comeback there from my insanity. It wasn't enough of a comeback for them to be even close to being even in this game, but it was a small light in the tunnel. Still a very long way to go, though. Moscow 5, interesting smoke. Their supports are moving around. Looks like PGG. Is he actually going for a solo kill here? Is he really going out for a solo kill on a hero that has a silence? This doesn't make sense. There he goes. He's setting up for Necroman to get here. There it is. Yule Scepter helps save Milan, but he'll be hit by the tornado. Slowed up again, and right click down. The bottle. Mitch tries to come in. They can get a counter kill here. PGG with the rest of the team coming in. Yeah, they'll lock him down. Chronosphere locks down Necroman even further. Oh, God. Oh, God, look at the heroes trapped inside the Chronosphere. Oh, Tiny beats down one, tosses another. Oh, disaster. They ran into the Chronosphere, and now Cole kited around. Say goodnight, Charlie Brown. Cole is, oh, God, Tornado misses. Cole trying to make some sort of grand escape here. Necroman slowed down by the ghosts. He's actually not going to make it. Cole manages to get himself out. Look at the bottom lane, though. This is where the real push is coming in. Tier 3 tower, doesn't matter if Cole survives if they're going to be losing a melee Rax by 21 minutes. Mitch, attempt at a double stun. Repel is still up, though, on the Tiny. Screen moving forward and then tethers back. They can get a Tornado or Yule Scepter on one of them, but Milan backs himself away. So their first set of Rax down by 21 minutes. Kind of to be expected at this point. They know they're going to lose on Rax. Like, that's just a given when you're this far behind. They just have to somehow soldier on for the next 10 to 15 minutes. See if they can make a comeback. It's all about the initiation, namely from our Faceless Void, but also potentially the Sand King. They need to be able to either lock down the Omni-Knight while they pop the rest of the heroes, or pop the Omni-Knight. And that gets even more difficult when Omni-Knight is now doesn't even have to be close to the team fight to be able to get off Guardian Angel. And Guardian Angel destroys Death Prophet. I mean, she's... Later on into the game, she's not a hero. Right now, Crypt Swarm still does some okay damage, but later on into the game... Your damage is all about exorcism. Radiant's middle tower has fallen. You're going to find that Guardian Angel is just going to wreck Milan. In fact, I would say Diffusal needs to be his next pickup somehow. Out of all the items that you need to go on a Death Prophet, Diffusal after Yule's is not the build you want to go for. But it might be his only option.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Necroman giving some good information for his team. waiting for his opportunity to initiate. They have to move forward eventually up against ZXC. And when they jump in, try and get a Chronosphere, that's when Necroman will strike with a tornado that intercepts a lot of that. Counter initiation. Oh, the whiff of the Chronosphere. Don't know what that was. Cole wasn't even close to hitting the mark on that one. Tries to go on Slander. Trying to bash him up, but he just gets tossed to his death. Screen just throws him around like a football, or ZXC rather, who's now going for Grazine. Nice cogs back. And they'll survive for a bit longer, but Milan won't. And Necroman lands on his head, and that's going to be the second set of racks with both of the big cores of My Insanity down. GG well played is called by Milan. And Moscow 5 took top of the division, and I would say definitely expected. They were able, the ones, to finish off the joinDOTA League European Division Finals, the winners, and able to take that first prize place. So congrats to them, though I'm sure they'll also have be very, very happy with the upcoming joinDOTA League that is going to be helped out by MLG. MLG and joinDOTA coming together to make a beautiful product. joinDOTA League is going to be so much more in the next season, where it is all about that big amount of MLG money that they put forward, all to be a part of the big MLG event. But there's also going to be the joinDOTA League. Every single division, every single season, rather, will have its own set of LAN finals. So something that's just going to make joinDOTA League a lot more special. We're going to be vamping that up. We're going to be doing a whole bunch more content. joinDOTA is pretty much going to be covering all of joinDOTA League in this next season that's coming up. So no longer, this is, for us, we always made the joinDOTA League as a, basically it was for the community, right? So it's for the scrim teams that people want to put together. It's for the amateur community to get interested in competitive Dota. It's for amateur casters to be able to cast some decent teams and get their opportunity to cast games as the only casters there. And I think it worked pretty damn well. I think a lot of people got a lot of exposure through casting the joinDOTA League, and we're very happy about that. But things are changing up with MLG partnering up with us. It's no longer going to be the case. joinDOTA is going to be back to casting all the joinDOTA games. And we also have WePlay as well as, ESL is going to be coming up. We have so many other things that have yet to be announced as well. So joinDOTA has a lot of stuff coming up. We're not going to be seeing us too much in this week or maybe the next, but you start towards the end of January, and we will be casting every single day. In fact, I believe towards the end of January, our schedule looks something like starting at 9 a.m. and ending at 2 a.m. All right, so for those of you guys, the rumors of joinDOTA being dead are completely off base. We're very much alive. We're very much kicking. We just had a bit of a break due to some unfortunate timings of stuff. So we are going to be coming full on back, and we hope you guys will be tuning in. Appreciate those of you guys who stuck around and watched. I know D2Ls should be going on by now. I know they had some serious delays, but thank you to you guys who were tuning in. We hit about 6,000 or 7,000 for the joinDOTA League finals. That's pretty damn good. So thank you to all you guys who are watching, and we will see you guys next time on the live stream, which I'm not sure when that's going to be, but just stay tuned to joindota.com.